Wow. Well, that's good. That's a good start. That's great. So you've all ticked the attendance box for coming here. So that's good. That's step one. Compliance done, basically.
So compliance.
You all attended. We can go, right? So thank you very much for attending the last session of a two-day conference. It's always a delight when you find out you're chairing the first session of day one and the last session of day two. That's always good news. Thanks, Don. But I am delighted to be chairing the session. I think it's going to be a really, really interesting session. I was having a discussion last night over a few beers saying, well, I've got the last session of day two and it's on compliance. And my colleague went, yeah, but you know one thing, everyone in that room wants to be there. So there you go. So give yourselves a round of applause to start off with. Come on. Compliance 18. Now, I'm wondering if that also means you are the most compliant people in Excel at the moment. So I'm going to test that theory, and I'm going to ask everybody who's not on one of the center sort of tables to come and join and fill the tables so we can have only full tables wherever possible, please. So if you can just gather in towards the middle, it will make it a much more engaging session, and it will look better on video for Louise and Sharon. So they can go, check it out, look, full house. Okay, so that'll be great if you could do that. Fabulous. Especially you guys at the back. Come on, join your friends, join your colleagues. See, friends reunited, this is what happens. It's all about connections, right? Social learning, peer-to-peer happening right now. Come on, guys. I'm not starting until you've moved, so it's up to you. It'll be a long session. Trust me, I do stand-up for a living. I will stand here with the mic longer than you sit there. I will sweat it out. I'm not kidding. Seriously. Come on. Come and join me on these tables. Come on, guys. Right. I'll give you 1 minute while I talk, and then I will check back in with you. And then I'll just pester you every 2 minutes from there on in. All right. So welcome to the last session. Have we had a good conference, people? Yeah, it's been good. Excellent. This is the session that comes between this and either beer or home. I am very conscious of that. So we will try and endeavour to run to time for you all. So this is going to be a great session. It's going to be a fairly interactive session. Lots of group work, lots of questions and answers. And I'm delighted to be working with two of the leading experts on what is a really interesting topic, I think, when you start to get into the nuts and bolts. So we're going to start off with a little bit of a warm-up exercise. I want you guys to have a little chat about compliance, right? And I want you to be honest about compliance. So just a quick show of hands, who in the room has been involved in creating any kind of compliance learning? Oh. Awesome. Who's been in the room has been on the other end of compliance learning? So some of you need to apologize to some other people. Right? Now is the time to make amends. So I want you to have a chat. I want you to talk about your approach to compliance learning. There is definitely someone on every table who's involved in creating it, and most of you are. And I want you to talk about, and I want you to be honest, it's perfectly fine to say, do you know what? I've reached the point now when a subject matter expert says, can we have 3,000 slides? I just say, yeah, whatever, it's fine. And I put it out. And I just keep sending emails at people, and eventually they just do it. That's fine. That's okay. You might be at the other end of the spectrum where actually you're like, do you know what? I was in that place. We've done something very different. This is what we've done. Either way, share that story. And then we'll pick one or two examples just as a starting point, and then I'll hand over to Louise and Sharon, who will take you through the rest of the session. Okay, so I'll just give you a couple of minutes. Just have a little chat. What goes in Excel stays in Excel. Okay, won't be reporting back to your bosses. All right. I wonder which group I'll go to first, guys at the back. So what was the non-compliant compliance team over here? What was the themes of your conversation?
And not engaging, and that a lot of people that have to take the course are always complaining that they have to do it. And yep. And the other side, there's the subject matter expert who says, yeah, you have to cover all these issues, and that's a challenge for everyone and that we have to find a solution.
Okay. So we've got learners who hate doing it, but subject matter experts who insist that every single word is relevant. Who's based in the UK? Just give me a show of hands, right? I'm going to assume that at some point you have all done health and safety at work training, yeah? Bonus points. Who can tell me what year the Health and Safety at Work Act came into force? 1974. Everybody knows that, don't they? Health and Safety Worker Act, 1974. You all fail. which does make me think, how many accidents do we think we've prevented in the last 40 years by us all knowing that the Act came into force in 1974? Yet I've never, ever been asked to create a piece of health and safety content without including the Health and Safety at Work Act, brackets, 1974. It's a challenge, isn't it? Yeah, you've got subject matters experts on one hand going, it's all important, all 3,000 slides. And you've got learners on the other going, really, again? Seriously? It's hard. So did anyone, I'm going to guess that's a theme with most tables, did anyone come up with anything radically different than nobody wants to do it, subject matter experts are tricky? What did we come up with over here?
One of the benefits of working at Dyson is everybody's mindset is quite different. Engineers by trade, and so they want to do things differently. I've been in my role for 6 months, and the first thing that I delivered was the code of conduct learning. And we've used things like Skype for Business, lookalike things using AI. So when you talk to this bot, the more complex your answers are, when you get things wrong, it responds to you in a different way to certify you. And because we've done it totally differently to how we've done compliance learning before, we've got quite a lot of people actually doing it and wanting to do it and then talking about it. It's gone well, and my completion rate globally is 98%, which we've never ever had anything like that before, because people want to do it. Thank you very much.
Make sure you see Don before you leave. Get your session next year. Okay. Anything other than that? So we've had a real extreme there, haven't we? We've had it's boring, nobody wants to do it, but the subject matter experts make us. And we've had actually, if you go down a different route, you can make it engaging. Anything other to add from that? That's pretty cool. Hello.
And so we're in a really lucky position that when we launch our learning platform in a month or so time, we can start by making the compliance engaging right from the off, and because people don't really understand what digital content is at the moment, our subject matter experts are just kind of leaving us to it because they don't really understand the impact that it's going to have. I think they're looking at it like, yeah, you do your thing, we'll carry on delivering our face-to-face compliance training. So we're in quite a lucky position from that perspective.
Yeah, it's a really interesting approach. I heard a similar approach recently where someone was saying there's a great opportunity to use your health and safety, your compliance training, whatever it is in your business, as your shop window. Because if you can make the stuff they have to do interesting, imagine what the sexy stuff's like. So I kind of get that approach. But equally, I've worked with people who take the complete opposite of, just make it as simple as you can to get it done. You know, it's not worth it. So, okay, I'm going to hand over to Louise and Sharon. So Louise has the most convoluted job title in the world, so I had to write it down, I'm afraid. So Louise is Global Sustainability Head of Enablement and Engagement.
Yes.
Trips off the tongue. So give her a round of applause.
Thank you.
And Sharon keeps it simple. She's VP North America for Learning Pool.
That'll be obvious with my accent.
So give her a round of applause too. So over to you guys.
All right. So my name's Sharon Claffey Kaliouby. I could give you the history as to why I'm here and what the mantra is. Doesn't really matter. The experience that mattered was my time at State Street Global Advisors. Previous to that, I thought I was in a compliant environment in a financial services, Thomson Financial, Thomson Reuters. I didn't have a clue what I was getting into. In the 4.5 years at State Street Global Advisors, I must have been in violation accidentally starting on day 11. So the impact of mandated Click Next training, which I thought I was fully prepared for, was a brand new experience. They purposely hired outside of the banking industry, which is different than financial services, to get a diversity of thought, which is great until you're given 20 plus hours of mandated training. So I'm going to express to you my perspective in the preparation for this. Louise and I found that we came from very different avenues in regard to mandated training. I'm coming from the perspective for this session from my banking background. And AstraZeneca is Louise's with more of the pharmaceutical, big pharma. So just a raise of hands so that we kind of know what part of the story you guys might relate to. Any folks out here from banking? holy moly. Okay, so if this was probably in Boston, it would be the whole room in the banking area. But this is amazing. This is great. So I'm going to show you this slice of the industry. This is some research I just did a couple of years ago. We checked it up until June 30th, 2019. We had found out that there's quite a bit of payment being made to regulators in regard to it going wrong. So when you look at these numbers, and you actually, and I think my coming on and was so scarred and horrified by what I had experienced. I'm a learning professional. How did I mess up on the 11th day where I didn't get to the training that needed to be done by that day? We did evolve and create a pre-boarding program that let new hires know this was required. But up until that point, I'd never seen this much training. And I was looking for it and couldn't find it. So that exposed me to this world of mandatory training, compliance training. And then when I actually got into the training, I couldn't see where behavior would be impacted. I couldn't even understand the click next value and where it was going. So no fault on the developers. The connection, though, to the business and the alignment was unclear. In the research, we saw why. And this also got resolved eventually, but not to the point where it's not still 14. I think it was 20 hours. They added some more in. And lastly, the average size of fines were draining. So the reality of it, and I checked in with many thought leaders just saying, am I imagining this, is the design of the courseware is not the solution by the regulators. That was something that the banks created. We'll check the box. We'll just give them training, get it off my plate. Nobody said you had to do that. Also, mandated training was not protecting the organization so that they could say, well, Joe Smith, Susie Quinn, it's on them. They took the mandated training. In fact, most times you only need to get an 80%. Is that true of anyone out there? Mm-hmm. Right? That's 20% that you might be wrong. And the second time, I actually tested out of a section. I was really proud of myself. I had tested out of the section that I needed to know in regard to a process. So, oops, I didn't know what I didn't know at that point. This just illustrates some of the research that I had conducted in regard to wondering why, as someone that loves and is passionate about learning and development, how did this all get turned upside down? We did a lot of research on this. I think for 5 years, I was doing sessions about going beyond Click Next training, getting feedback from individuals in Europe, as well as Europe, Ireland, as well as the US. And this was really neat is we actually looked at some of the percentages. We found that most people don't respect it based on the way that it's designed. Now, this doesn't have to be for everyone's compliance. I hope you all have great stories. But when Louise and I were talking, we just had a whole different look and outlook. And I won't ruin the foreshadowing of how awesome that is. But it was really interesting to see that, you know, they already know 53% of the content. So my manager had been in banking 22 years, and she was taking the exact same program that I was taking. I should have probably had the 2.5 hour version, and she probably should have had a 10 or 15 minute version, but we were being served up in the same slice as if we were all exactly the same. We're also in a learning area, which meant I wasn't contacting the customers yet because it was just easier to throw it out. It went out to all of us. So I was getting the exact same training that maybe some of the customer facing folks were. And that goes into relevance. So this doesn't even go into the flashiness of is it on mobile, you know, is it looking really pretty, do I have people jumping out at me? As we move forward, we started to say, is there a better way to engage in explaining how you can get complicated content? So although this might not be compliance ridden, I found the concept of the financial industry and the banking world really hard to get in. And I needed to know this in order to pass the mandated training, because there was no little link to explain to me where I was. So out of humor, I thought it would be cool to see through some movies how complicated financial terms can be explained. And you let me know if you think, I mean, anyone notice Margot there? How many times would you take that course out of intrigue? And Selena Gomez, this is a real athletic side of designing that. So I don't know if I pushed the button or if you started up. Okay, so. And apologies if there's any bad language.
Say that again. CDOA has parts of CDOB, and CDOB has parts of CDOA, but then they both get put inside CDOC.
Yeah, that one's called CDO squared. CDO of a CDO.
SME moment there. Right?
And then there's CDOs made up of the opposite side of the bed you may reach swaps. We call them synthetic CDOs.
What is synthetic CDOs?
Synthetic CDOs.
That is fucking crazy.
Sorry.
It's not. It's awesome. His face is starting to boil. He looks like the bad guy from Doom.
All right, let's say you have a pool of 50 million in subprime loans. How much money could be out there betting on it in your synthetic CDOs and swaps right now, tonight?
$50 million. $1 billion.
What?
If the mortgage bonds that Michael Burry discovered were the match.
How much bigger is the market for insuring mortgage bonds than actual mortgages?
About 20 times. If the mortgage bonds were the match, and the CDOs were the kerosene-soaked rags, then the synthetic CDO was the atomic bomb with the drunk president holding his finger over the button. It was at that moment in that dumb restaurant with that stupid look on his face that Mark Baum realized the whole world economy might collapse. And I know what you're thinking. What
so
the
we can
fuck
move
is a
little
synthetic
bit
CDO?
Along
well,
yeah,
here's
this
Dr.
is great.
Richard
this is
Thaler,
great.
Father of behavioral economics, and Selena Gomez to explain.
So there's our subject matter expert.
Okay, so here's how a synthetic CDO works. Let's say I bet $10 million on a blackjack hand.
$10 million because this hand is meant to represent a single mortgage bond. Okay, Selena has a pretty good hand here, showing 18, dealer showing 7. That's a really good hand for Selena. Good odds. In fact, her chances of winning this hand
are 87%.
So I'm
going to talk through some of this so you don't get caught up. There's a neat area where they actually do an illustration
streak
with a cartoon.
Everybody in this place wants to get in.
In the banking
match
industry, I had not seen corporate learning delivered
in
such a real cool experiential. So we get basketball here. I actually like to play basketball.
People are sure they're going to make the next one. People think whatever.
All of a sudden, the terminology started resonating
with
me. And
future.
I could relate it to something that mattered that I could recall in my own past. You see the excitement. Does anyone ever see that in compliance training?
Watching and think
yeah!
That they won't lose, we'll make a side bet. Now, this is the first
so we can stop on this video.
Bet you 50 million.
And then we'll just jump a little bit in that. Just quickly, how many people see compliance training explained the details involved? Does anyone have the opportunity to do that, to have the video come out and kind of relate to the population? It's hard, it's not easy. When you do it though, you can see that I was watching that movie, The Big Short, just to even understand what happened in 2008, because it was impacting the mandated training that I was experiencing in 2016, 17, 18. This one's just a cute one, we won't go through all of it, but it's really neat to see the engagement of a hard topic being kind of dressed up. Now, this isn't to be, I just did the hashtag Women in Learning session. The point of this is to think outside the box where you might not think of financial terms being explained in a bubble bath. There's a bleep or two here, so I will make sure to.
Mortgage-backed securities, subprime loans, tranches. It's pretty confusing, right? Does it make you feel bored or stupid? Well, it's supposed to. Wall Street loves to use confusing terms to make you
like
think only
they
can do what they do.
Training?
Or even better, for you just to leave them the fuck alone.
Oh, sorry.
So here's Margot Robbie in a bubble bath to explain.
Basically, Louis Raineri's mortgage bonds were amazingly profitable for the big banks. They made billions and billions on their 2% fee.
So she goes in, she swears a couple more times, so I just want to make sure that that doesn't get overused. The point of that video was, when I've shown this before, how many people would return to a learning course that has an intrigue, a relatable figure, somebody that's talking to you about the subject matter, maybe outside and not in a cartoon format that has no relevance to why you're even looking at it. That seems to have been where our research was able to prove that relevance mattered, not the mode. It's super awesome if you can get it to be, you know, mobile, all that. The research that we did, they said they didn't care. They wanted it relevant. They wanted, in my opinion, to be able to get 100%, not 80. 80 is not good enough. When you're in a bank and you're being sued $61 billion because somebody in XYZ location didn't do the right thing, then that becomes a really serious issue for the reputation of the company, of the bank, or the organization. And it also becomes very serious in regard to your future business going forward. So just saying, once you think outside the box, and I think we're going to get some amazing examples with Louise's world, I'm kind of like telling it as, this is why it gets a bad name. This is why Click Next mandated training would fill up, but more in the issue of, this is what I don't like. This is why I can't understand why we haven't moved beyond it. Now, it could be worse. This could be a location scenario, but I will be delighted, and I was amazed at what Louise will show as far as the evolution of where mandated training came. The other thing is, do not add people in that do not need to take the training. That is really best explained by the experts themselves and maybe a more informal location. To mandate 30,000 people because it checks the box off doesn't get the work done. We also did research. We interviewed the ops group, and we found out that their retention in less than 6 months, actually I think it was three, was only 23%. So, and that's not abnormal. That's actually a standard for walking away from it. So had we, and we checked, created something more engaging, more relatable, and more relevant to their job, their years of experience, and their knowledge of the topic, very much so. And with the, you know, the learning technologies that are to come, this is not out of the question. But this almost supports the direction that we see the industry going. So with that, I'll hand it over to Louise.
Thank you, Sharon.
Just a quick question, though. How relatable? Did any of that resonate with you, just dumping it out to the entire populations, or do you guys feel as though it's kind of done more streamlined? Does anyone have it that some training just goes out for the sake of it to the entire population? Okay.
Cool. Okay. Thank you. I'm very fortunate to work for a very progressive big pharma company in the way that we view compliance. So 5 years ago, within my organization, sustainability was one person that reported into the VP of operations and compliance. As of 2 years ago now, sustainability is a function of 250 people, including compliance. And the great thing about that is we can start shifting that focus now from compliance to ethics. It's one word. It may not seem like much of a difference, but it brings so much more to the table. In terms of my background, I will hold my hand up. 5 years ago, I was not a learning professional. I don't have a long career history in learning. I don't know a thing about compliance. And actually, it's proved incredibly successful. In fact, a mentor said, never learn about compliance. Please don't. Because you're helping people understand what we know too much about. I'm also a bit of a tech geek. And I like thinking about how we make changes, how we make a difference, and put the learner first. So this was an interesting challenge. Can we take compliance learning, can we take it out of the LMS and do something a little bit different with it? So for me, compliance, and I'm a simple person, kind of revolves around two things. Do the right thing and speak up if you see something that's not right or you're not sure. And you get that, you get a compliant organization. So the challenge I had was around speak up and what that meant and the connotations. But to my mind, when I put my learner hat on, which I suppose I never really take off, how much culture change am I going to achieve within an organization sitting in front of a laptop, having a personal experience? I mean, someone might say, did you take the training? Yeah. Did you like it? Yeah. It's not going to start dialogue. It's not going to make that cultural change. And what do people understand by speak up? And this is an interesting challenge I had with compliance professionals that I work with, that for them it's whistleblowing. For them it's all about raising those big concerns, stopping those big things happening. But is that what we want to do? If we think ethically, speaking up is speaking up about really small things, so that hopefully they never get to be big things. And if there are big things, having the comfort and the confidence as an employee to do that. And interestingly, do we all speak up in the same way? I work for a global organization, and this was illuminating to me. If I look at a Western concept of speaking up, completely different when you go to China. You know, as a pupil in a Chinese school, you are actively taught not to speak up. And then you put them in a Western organization and think it will be fine. And it's really not. It's really, really complicated. So what I thought we needed to do was start a conversation. And I can't imagine how we do that through e-learning on an LMS platform. Absolutely doesn't work. So I thought digitally, what do we have? And about 8 months prior, we'd launched Workplace. I don't know if any of you guys have Workplace. It's kind of Facebook at work. It's a social media platform. And I thought, this is interesting. People are starting to come out of their shells a little bit. Is this the place where we start dialogue? So we created a whole marketing campaign around a series of videos using hashtags, very trendy, speak up, your voice matters. And we really wanted to champion that diversity of thought within the business. It was a real learning curve for me because this is the one piece of training that I think I've ever created where I really wouldn't mind if people hated it. So if the comments were bad, people were speaking up. Job done, right? So what we thought is we would try and champion speak up in all its levels. So we created a series of videos. We built up to it. We got that curiosity going. What's this going to be about? We started off, I'll show you in a minute, with something really simple. We ended up with something a little bit different. But let me show you what we did. And this is all filmed in AstraZeneca offices with actors, so people didn't get labelled.
Oh, hi. Oh, by the way, congratulations on the promotion. Gary, I'm really sorry I spilt coffee on your paper.
Thanks for your honesty. We're trying to get paperless anyway.
So that was just a light-hearted scenario to start the campaign off a little bit. But to get people interacting and really to try and test the temperature of how people felt that they could speak up within AstraZeneca, the really interesting thing about this was the first comment that came after launch, and we were sitting there bracing ourselves. And we'd scripted it, and we'd worked really hard with our partners to get it right. And the first thing someone said was, I couldn't speak up to that man. He didn't even acknowledge me when I said, thanks for the promotion. Was not intentional. Was not in the script. We hadn't thought about it. We were all busy watching it again, going, oh my God, yeah, no, fair point. And that was the amazing thing about this campaign. People saw things that we didn't see. It was amazing. I'll just show you the last one. So as I say, we went up in severity and we talked about really interesting things. So we talked about things like course correction. So speaking up in a meeting that's about to end and actually somebody having the courage to say, you know what, I think we need to spend a little bit more time on this. We talked around mental health and well-being. So we had a speak up session on someone that was really struggling, really stressed, but taking on that burden themselves. And then we finished with this.
Good night. I'm heading off now.
Okay. See you tomorrow. Yeah.
Bye.
Can I just check that I understand this? It should work like this, right?
You're totally off track here.
What's missing? Sorry, do you mind taking me through it?
Look, it's your job to get up to speed. I know you're new to the project team, but I don't have time to spend explaining all of this. If you want something, Done well, do it yourself.
Can we push back the deadline? I'm not sure that staying late a few days is going to be enough.
Relax. We'll get it done. Maybe if you spent less time asking silly questions, you'd be further ahead. Look, I know I've been coming down hard on you, but it's just because I want you to do well here.
Sometimes there are no options, so they've been through a whole load of scenarios with people making choices to speak up or not. Sometimes that still makes that my head stand on end. It's just, yeah, very creepy. But so we had the whole remit, and then what we did after that was we got some key people within the business that everybody knew to reflect on the video, to talk about their experience, and our EVP of HR spoke to this so passionately. You know, we will not tolerate this. This can never happen. You can speak to me if you need to. And we got an amazing response from it. People were really engaged. Now, did everybody in the company take it? No, it was on a social media platform. Did it have 70,000 views, which is all the people in AstraZeneca? No, it didn't. But it started something. It started a dialogue, a conversation, a movement. And by having the ability to thought, to think, and knowing that people weren't shutting you down, which is really important in the comments section, knowing that you were able to speak your mind and start to speak up, it really started to change behaviors. It was great, it was trending. We saw loads of people create their own stuff. We didn't ask them to, but it was popping up in South Africa, in Asia, in America. It was amazing. And, you know, it sat outside the learning management system but started to change behavior. And we need people to speak up. We need people to speak up early. We need them to be able to speak up about anything that they need to. And then that stops these major issues happening in the first place. But, you know, I was trying to think about how to word it. And it's not about necessarily what you create, the training course you create in the room. But it's about the fires that you can create within the employees that really, really matters when it comes to compliance. Because, you know, we give someone a 50-page read and sign SOP if we want to tick the box and satisfy the regulators. What we don't want to happen is for the bad thing to happen in the first place, right? Okay. So over to you, Sharon.
So I think it's awesome that we kind of came to a conclusion in the years while I was at the bank. We went outside the LMS. Actually, we didn't have an official one initially, but we decided it really matters that people understand what's going on. So that's something that I think is really, really important is if you want to get that behavior change, sometimes you have to think outside the box and think outside the LMS. We started to say, what can we do with little to no budget, and also acknowledging there's great partnerships with vendors on this. I'm new to Learning Pool, and they have an amazing array of compliance-type training, unlike what I've seen before, based on AI machine learning, and Louise can even speak to who she had worked with as well. And I think it's important to note that sometimes you need to ask for help. What we did is we had a videographer in the company, and we said, you know, with the code of ethics and people coming on, there was a lack of clarity based on so many reorgs and executives coming and going. Did they understand the value proposition of the company? And our goal was, well, if we do enough off the LMS dialogues, we actually had a speak up, listen up session. That's what I thought was really kind of cool. I had nothing approved that I could show, but kind of start with that topic. It seems to have been very successful in a number of companies. I did some research. speak up, listen up. You know, just the common sense, but maybe not for everyone. So what we created here, and I'm just going to show you, is what we called a mashup. And we started with something that didn't say this is compliance training or this is even mandated. So once again, this was off the LMS on a portal. And it was trying to educate and say, how would you explain the value proposition of the bank? And in doing so, we did interviews all around the world. And you'll see which ones are the formal executives and which ones were folks that were, at least one that looks like she's hiding away. And you understood the value of videotaping, but the folks all did this on their own and they sent them into us. We branded it Knowledge Now.
Hi, my name is Chuck Moon.
My name is Lance Graham.
Hi, my name is Bob Finelli.
We understand that clients face significant challenges in order to meet their long-term objectives and liability.
To understand a client's problem from multiple different dimensions.
So we had buy-in from the executives as well as the employee base.
And it's important that we have that breadth of
product
so as to be able to meet those needs.
Clients look to us as a trusted partner to understand deeply what they're trying to accomplish.
Listen to our clients, understand their needs and goals.
Clients' needs vary based on their business, regulatory, and risk requirements.
So
one solution is not going to fit
information.
All.
SSGA is unique in having a broad and deep footprint in global markets.
I'd recognize to you that the risk characteristics can be very different from client to client.
We believe that markets aren't always efficient and there may be behavioral biases, informational efficiencies, inefficiencies, and limits to arbitrage.
Efficient portfolios can be built with smart combinations of exposures and risks by skillful managers.
It's a great advantage to be able to leverage the expertise across the different disciplines.
Right?
We believe that we need to be thoughtful about how we partner with our clients and about how we help them to build investment portfolios that achieve their investment goals, but within
risk
tolerances.
So this turned out to be really intriguing. We did not go with the intention of creating a mashup. We had a graphic designer that had just looked into coming into learning. We partnered together. And what we were amazed with is when we were looking at all the videos that came in, they were finishing each other's sentences. We weren't, the goal here was to have clear, confident, and consistent understanding and messaging of the company. That's all we were shooting for. And what we came up with, it still even gives me chills a bit that as they were coming in and I was working with this individual, I'm like, keep the beat, make it move. We created our own ability to promote and market and say, you hear in there, if you listen, it's the underlying tone is be ethical. Do the right thing. Make sure you get that message across. Now, there's more expensive ways of doing this and more flashier ways. We hadn't had anything this YouTube-y-like, and once again, this wasn't to go public. This was to be used internally. But we did see an impact and a bit more understanding and a change in behavior in regard to what they were being asked for and that yearly code of ethics and messaging of that. So that was the closest I could come to the beautiful stuff that Louise had. But it was something that was homegrown and something that you can do on a corporate iPhone, even in the banking institution. Let's see. Okay.
So the example before was something different, but what if you have to do stuff on the LMS, right? I do, every year. And my colleagues who are actually sitting at the front, we are creators of the two pieces of mandatory learning that everybody in AstraZeneca takes, code of ethics, cybersecurity. And it is the benchmark for learning within an organization because everybody sees it. But you can use digital and you can use a different way of thinking and a different mindset. You can think about the why to enhance that experience. So for me, one course, 80,000 people are gonna take it, all around the world, including third parties, English plus 10 languages. It has to be on the LMS. This goes in our annual report that everybody's taking it. We have to do that. But how can you take such a widespread course and make it feel personal, like you've tailored it to the individual, when you have a limited budget? And how do you learn from the feedback that you get from learners? Again, I was a learner, not a learning professional. I've never got rid of that on purpose. So I go out to learners. I still am a little bamboozled about people in the learning industry that create a course and then they get feedback and then they found out how good the course was. Why aren't you building the course with the people in the first place? It makes no sense. But we wanted to put a why behind it. So actually we had a new company strategy this year, growth through innovation. Okay, fine. What can I do with that? How can I give some purpose? Compliance is really hard to do that. When you think ethics, ethics and innovation, that's quite interesting. Okay, that's going to take me somewhere. And so what we did was we built a course around these three main growth through innovation areas for my company: patient centricity, putting patients at the heart of what we do, doing more with data and digital, and being a great place to work. What does that mean in terms of ethics and in terms of compliance? When you talk about it in the context of business, it doesn't feel like compliance training. And there's a reason and a why behind it. And we like people to be curious. We learn about our campaigns. Don't deliver courses. Deliver campaigns with a course in the middle of it. So we create trailers, we create interest, we create intrigue, and we always have something new. So people are going to go into their Code of Ethics course and say, what have they done this year? And one of the best bits of feedback we ever had was last year. And we got it from quite a few of our learners, and they went, you know, course was great and everything, but everyone that you had speaking, all your talking heads were filmed in the Cambridge office. They were speaking English. I thought, okay, you're right. You're absolutely right. And so we worked with our learning provider, Sponge, to say, how can we change this? So instead, we've made a rule now. It will stay forever. But we were the first course within AstraZeneca to say, you speak in whatever language you want. And make sure we had representation from China, from Brazil, from Warsaw. You know, there's a lot of people in the US and the UK. They're just going to read subtitles from now on. And just to give you a little bit of an idea, in terms of what that course looked like, and I'm sure you're going to be speaking here next year doing this from what you've said, but we kept it really vibrant. We used things like fake instant message conversations, so you could actually have a Skype conversation with people rather than having to choose ABC and all of the above. You know, English subtitles, Chinese language. There's the IM conversation. So you're getting a feel around ethics. Compliance is right or wrong. Ethics is, how did it make you feel? We had one of the questions was about a young scientist who was daydreaming, mixed up his samples of blood. Do you speak up, for example? And you could say, how did you feel? What did your manager say? How did it get resolved? You can't normally say that within an e-learning. But again, we had really impressive results in terms of what we did. So 5,000 completions on the launch date, that might not sound like a lot. We launch on a Sunday. So that's a huge percentage of our workforce that are logging on and seeing what it's all about. And we were 89% complete in 30 days, not 90. We got over 2,000 pieces of voluntary feedback. That's going to help us so much in creating next year's course, really understanding what bits worked and what didn't. And this is the sort of feedback, the good feedback that we get. I quite like the bad feedback now. I've learned to be less precious about it and actually realize that's the only way I'm going to make things better. But the way information was delivered was very creative, made it interesting, and we know this is good with learning. Also enjoyed seeing my colleagues from around the world make an appearance and share their real life experiences. This was their stories. This wasn't scripted. This is exactly what they wanted to say, the way that they said it. And you know, broad range of situations across the company where we should make considered ethical decisions and making the company's principles clear. And ethics instead of conduct, code of ethics, code of conduct, it empowers people. Conduct is what's done to you. We all have ethics. We all want to be a part in it. So changing that conversation really changes the way people feel about taking the course, and they actually can come away from compliance training feeling quite energized. So,
over to you, yeah, Anthony. I'd like to summarize. Even it was interesting. I was like so shocked and impressed by the way AstraZeneca had been doing it. Yet the few areas of success that we both hit on was that global appeal, having the language not be a barrier and making sure that everybody was a part of it. Our videos weren't scripted, so you could see like the different angles. I loved the engagement that you had on yours. I loved the selective on what was mandated. So for me, it was like a dream, but we were even corresponding and I was like, no, this is some of this is for real. But I think for the first time in my experience of delivering this topic, it came with maybe not the problem, but the status quo, and then where the vision could lead to. So that was, I've never had a happy ending on this story. So I'm like, I was amazed, and it was such a pleasure to learn more about this through Louise. So,
thank you, Sharon.
Questions?
Can we have this mic up?
So we use Sponge 2, so it looks just like that. We can share notes afterwards. But one of the challenges I now have at Dyson are, how do you impact colleagues in manufacturing? So you obviously manufacture drugs. Mm-hmm. We manufacture machines, but we do that all in Asia, and our English literacy and also digital literacy in our factories in Asia are, you know, poles apart from what we have in the rest of the world. What have you done to try and get that message to those populations?
Yeah, well, certainly in our main production sites, we have computers available for people to take their courses. Obviously, everything's multi-device as well. So people can actually access our LMS through their own personal phone or laptop, so they can take the course that way. There are some areas where, again, we have a problem with literacy, only sort of two or three countries that I can think of. And what tends to happen there is that people will translate and facilitate a session,
yep,
and check understanding and awareness.
Yep. And have you created the same, so that the version that you showed there, would that be the same for everybody? So again, for manufacturing, did you change
yeah.
it to be more relevant to that field?
No, this is the interesting thing. When you link it to company strategy, when you make it simple, and we talk about principles rather than rules, that was the old way for compliance training. I used to hate taking that. There would be so many acronyms and nuances. A sales rep goes into a doctor, I don't know, why are they asking me this? But if you pose an ethical question and you take it to the principles rather than rules around that, and you are educating people about the company, different parts of the company, different parts of the company strategy, we find that they're really engaged. So we don't have to have a course that's just for operations and really nuanced and really subtle. Because again, it's about doing the right thing and speaking up when you need to, and understanding those overarching principles.
Thank you.
So I really enjoyed those videos, or the videos that you showed us, and you as well, but I think
not as good as hers.
So I think that that's something that we really struggle with in my organization. We're only 150 people, though, and I think that based on a lot of the cultural issues and HR issues that we have that don't go addressed, we could really use something like that. How do you recommend scaling that for an organization that is much smaller and has a smaller budget than AstraZeneca has and much fewer resources?
Put his hand up.
So my learning team has a relatively small budget for such a big company, and we use video a lot. You would be amazed how good video you can get from a smartphone and a reasonably mm-hmm. cheap mic, particularly for interview stuff. Just keep it stable in a well-lit room with an external mic. You will not know the difference.
Yeah, I have to echo that strongly. We had zero budget. So we actually were able to get, when you get someone that they recognize or that they've been on the phone with, that's the value, and that's why I even added in the mashup. It really resonated because it was from the organization. So I think that you'd be surprised, and we just used phones and a box or somehow it technically got there without much effort.
Yeah. And one tip I'd give you is find those engaging people in the business. They're never, not always leaders, for example. You don't always mm-hmm. need a senior leader in a video. I always say to people, I always say to people, say you're dialing into a Skype call and there's 10 names and there's
I'm sorry, I'm still caught on the
yeah, say you're dialing into a Skype call or a business meeting and there's 10 names and you see one name and you go, oh, it's going to be a good meeting. That's the person that you want to record.
Yeah, and I think making it clear, as you can see, the people that were at the desk versus the people that were kind of like hiding away. We got really positive feedback about that, and folks would even jump on to see how so-and-so did it. We didn't criticize on that, so that was another tolerance level that we had to give. This is purposely not being smooth and fancy looking.
Cool.
Thank you.
Who else?
Hey.
Thanks. So a lot of the
the stuff that you shared, it's really insightful, but a lot of it is just general awareness purposes. How do you really tackle the compliance training aspects? So some of the more complex, so if you're in pharma, for example, HIPAA compliance in the US, for instance, how is that sort of compliance training delivered in an impactful way that the business really understands and they find relevant?
Do you want me? I can just jump in briefly, yeah, because that has to come. I can't state the solutions that I'd seen in the past, but what I learned in that research was working and partnering with vendors out there that, to me, that's going to take a little bit of money right now. With the AI and machine learning, having the ability to filter through and be able to gravitate to relevance. That's what we saw. Video wasn't even as important, but that's a low cost. But relevance to the individual so that regardless of your years of experience, your knowledge that you're coming in with, and the ability to execute on that, you can minimize and have that be completely tracked on a learning management system. I'm seeing what Learning Pool's doing now. I know in the research it was what filtered, and it was amazing to see the potential. So I would say, even if you don't have a budget right now, there were wonderful folks downstairs. It doesn't matter which ones. Start doing a little bit of homework and kind of lean on that vendor environment and say, well, how would this look if someday something were to happen? It will inspire and be a catalyst for quite a bit of solutions that you might be able to come up with. I don't know, Louise, if you had something.
Yeah, and obviously I actually have an in-house team that also create materials in-house as well, which is great when we think about anti-bribery, anti-corruption, data privacy and the like. I am of the opinion this is learning. This isn't ticking a box. We can do that really easily with a read and sign, but I hate those. Sometimes companies, and I work in a heavily regulated industry, sometimes they become ruled by rules, and it leads to paralysis, and then you get compliance being felt of as the police or blockers, and actually not the enablers that they are. So actually, for me, really purposeful training boils it down and talks about the overarching principles. If you can get a message around principles across, you don't need to know every specific rule. You kind of know whether it's right or wrong a little bit, which I think is a really important thing to do. Mm-hmm. And again, tailor that in-house training you do, we tailor it, we target it. Because it's in-house, because it's in our hands, how we change it or how we adapt it. So yes, these aren't the only two pieces that we do, but I still believe that it's around having a good sense of what might be right or wrong, rather than knowing every single. We're not trying to teach people in AstraZeneca to become an army of compliance professionals. They don't want that, we don't want that. We want them to make drugs, very innovative drugs that help save patients' lives.
That's great. I think the point of relevance is really important as well. You can either invest a little bit of money figuring out how to make it more relevant, or you can waste a whole load of money not bothering and take everybody's time and effort. It's a choice that I think companies need to face.
And people making that decision are typically not people that know the value of L&D. Sometimes it's someone that's just like, I'm checking the box off, let's just slide it off. Yeah. Making sure too, I think what was great when we were meeting is the communication campaign versus the, I know exactly what you're talking about, when you need to get the details of the specifics. Knowing when you can throw something in the communication area will make the impact greater on that which you do not need. You cannot do that. Not that you do not want to. You cannot. So.
Cool. Any more?
Hello. So I recently joined AstraZeneca. So I had my first onboarding experience for quite a long time. And I have to say, there was a wide range of trainings that I had to go through as part of the onboarding. But two of them absolutely blew me out the water. So much so that I had to find out where they came from. Because when I looked at the star rating underneath the training, I had never seen anything like it. And I've been in learning and development more than 20 years. So I did a bit of fishing around, and I found out that Louise was responsible. So we had a conversation, didn't we, around, you know, how did this happen, and how did you manage to get it to that point? And I think it's a truly inspiring story that you have to share, and it's quite unusual because I come at it from a delegate perspective and not a learning perspective. So for me, thank you, because it was a standout learning experience that I wasn't expecting to have, and I'd never seen anything like it before. So I think you've done a brilliant job with that, Louise.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Now that feels like a good point to finish. But if there is any more questions, we'll be around for a little while. But I would never want to be the one to get in the way of you and journeys home. So have a safe weekend. Have safe journeys. I hope you had a fantastic conference. Those of you who are kicking around the UK this weekend, just watch out for the weather. There's another storm coming. Woohoo!
Oh, no.
Hopefully it's blowing the other direction, and I'll get to see my trampoline again. So. Have a wonderful time. I'll go and see you for some beers, but otherwise, come and have a chat, and we'll speak soon. Cheers, everybody.